children, and his grace is sufficient to stand the storm, and his word is a promise you can't stand on when the winds of this world is blowing strong. Oh, I know Jesus is with me when the storm clouds gather. He's standing by my side when I hear the thunder roll. He holds my hand when I begin to tremble, when the winds of this world is blowing strong. Oh, now Satan is moving to and fro throughout the land, and he's seeking whom he may devour. Oh, but he was defeated at Golgotha. Oh, that day when Jesus made him out a liar. Well, I said Jesus is with me when the storm clouds together. He's standing by my side when I hear the thunder roll. He holds my hand when I begin to tremble, when the winds of this world is blowing strong. Well, now Satan is sneaking to and fro. Oh, he's trying to lead some sheep astray. Oh, but he that's within us is so much greater than him, and we'll rebuke him and chase him away. Well, I know Jesus is with me when the storm clouds gather. He's standing by my side when I hear the thunder roll. He holds my hand when I begin to tremble, when the winds of this world are blowing strong. Oh, now Satan is sneaking, oh, sneaking around the land. He's seeking whom he may devour. Oh, but he was defeated at Golgotha. Oh, that day when Jesus made him out a liar. Oh, I know Jesus is with me when the storm clouds gather. He's standing by my side when I hear the thunder roll. And he holds my hand when I begin to tremble, when the winds of this world are blowing strong. Oh, now if you've been caught out in the winds of this world with no joy in your life at all, well, just give your heart to Jesus. He will always understand, and he will never let you fall. And I know Jesus is with me when the storm clouds gather. He's standing by my side when I hear the thunder roll. He holds my hand when I begin to tremble, when the winds of this world is blowing strong. Oh, now Satan is always sneaking around the gate and trying to lead some poor sheep astray.
Yes,
oh, but he that's within us is so much greater than him, and he'll rebuke him and chase him.
And I've got something for you today that is really, really important. Really important. The miracle of the supernatural blood. Did you know that even the Holy Ghost does not operate apart from the blood? And did you know that the Bible, as great as every promise is, does not stand on anything but the blood? So the Holy Spirit, as great as this person of the Godhead is, and the Word of God, which he's elevated even above his name, great as they are, the blood of Jesus Christ is the final answer for every human need. If you've never learned to live by the blood, then you're not living a victorious life. You're having difficulty. I don't know what it might be. It may be a multiplicity of things. It may be one or two. It may be a dozen. But I'm here to tell you, you've got to learn to live by the blood of Jesus Christ. Now, we're going to talk about the blood today, the supernatural elements of the blood, the supernatural power of the blood. And if the church has any need this hour, it is to come back to the simplicity of teaching and preaching and learning to live under the power of the blood of Jesus Christ. Now, many people think they can do it without even being conscious of it, without ever mentioning it. No, that's not possible. Whatever you are is what comes out of these lips. We overcome by the testimony of our lips. Did you know that? Well, what is the testimony? It is our dependency on the blood of Jesus Christ. Now, I've got so much to do. So many ways to go here today that I want to get to all of them, but you're going to have to help me. And I really want your questions. I love questions on a subject like this, because if I don't arouse some questions in you, I haven't done my job well. Maybe that's my problem. I don't know. But I'm trying to do my job well, and I have prepared, I think, excellently to be ready for this broadcast. This telecast, this radio broadcast. We're going in different directions, internet, radio, Facebook. I love them all. We put it on a CD and send them to people anywhere in the world. I mean, we are here to get you a message that will change your life and first and foremost, save your soul. Save your soul. I weep over every sinner that I know. I weep over every person I see on the street often. I'll see somebody and they're wallowing around and you can tell their life is going nowhere. And my heart hurts. I hurt. I bear their burden. I was thinking a while ago, we had four teens on visitation this past Tuesday night. And that's the most we've had. We started a little over a year ago with two teams, I think, three teams then, and now four teams. We're hoping for several more. And you know what? If you're going to be a visitation worker, if you're going to go out there and knock on doors, you need the wisdom of God. You need the wisdom of God to know how to approach each person with an individuality according to their specific needs. You have to approach people in a way they understand and they grasp, and they can communicate with you, and you can communicate with them. And so if you want to be a soul winner and lead people to Christ, you need some wisdom that only the Holy Spirit can give you. Nobody else can give it to you. The Holy Spirit has to give it to you. And I've heard people floundering around through the years and just kind of felt sorry for them because they didn't even know what they were doing. And our visitation workers are not perfect yet. We're trying hard. We're striving at it. And we want to do it right. But I'm telling you, the blood of Jesus is the answer. Let me read it to you in the book of Hebrews, chapter 10, one of the greatest passages in the Bible. Having therefore, brethren, boldness to enter into the holiest by the blood of Jesus. Prayer without the complete dependency on the blood is a waste of your time. Prayer that does not call on and depend on the blood is a waste of your time. Now, let me read that verse again. Having therefore, brethren, boldness to enter into the holiest. That's the place of prayer. The place of deep, real, mighty prayer. By the blood of Jesus. By a new and living way. By a new and living way which he hath consecrated for us through the veil. Through the veil, that is to say, his flesh. His flesh. Now, he shed the blood of his flesh. And so the flesh was a holy vessel. The blood was pure blood, divine blood that coursed through his veins. And so that flesh of Christ offering the blood that was divine is the means of our complete and utter redemption. There is no redemption apart from that blood. Now listen, and having a high priest, this is Jesus Christ, over the house of God, over the house of God, let us draw near with a true heart, in full assurance of faith, having our hearts sprinkled from an evil conscience, and our bodies washed with pure water. That's the word, the pure word of God. Our bodies washed with the blood of Jesus and the pure word of God. Now, there probably aren't any verses that are more powerful than those verses. Hebrews 10, begin with verse 19. If you want to make a note and go read them, Hebrews 10, 19. And it shows that this redemption of ours is by the blood of Jesus Christ. Your victory every day way of your Christian walk is by the blood of Jesus Christ. I have a thought on further down, but I don't mind getting to it early. If you are a young Christian and you've really been born again, I want to tell you that you will never grow and never mature and never become of any value to God if right now, as a young born-again Christian, you do not learn the value of the blood. And learn that your victory is in the blood of Jesus Christ. Now, why is my victory in the blood? Because Jesus Christ has defeated the devil by the cross of Calvary and the shedding of his blood. The one thing the devil cannot go over top of and cannot defeat. The devil cannot stop it. The devil cannot hinder it. And that is the power of the blood of Jesus Christ. The power of the blood is absolutely victorious. The power of the blood is absolutely victorious. Now, I want you to understand this. The only power that the church can use to change this messed up world is the power of the blood. If we don't preach the blood and the suffering of Christ and his death on the cross and the glory of the gospel in the cross of Jesus Christ, then we will fail and we will not get the job done. We may create a bunch of religious people. We may fill a so-called sanctuary with a bunch of morally decent people, but they may be lost, or they will be lost if they've not trusted in the blood of Jesus Christ. And they will not grow and become usable Christians in God's kingdom unless we teach them the power of the blood. And I'm crying out to you today. I'm going to be teaching, doing several programs on miracles and what are the sources of miracles. How can there be miracles? Well, it all starts with the word and the blood. Last week, you know, I dealt with the miracle of the Bible. The miracle of a pure, infallible Bible. And now I'm dealing with the miracle of the blood of Jesus Christ, the Son of God. I want to say this again. The only power that can change this messed up world is the power of the blood. The only power that can save your sons and your daughters is the power of the blood. If you've got a son that's got on drugs, your victory over those drugs is the power of the blood. If you will learn to depend upon the blood. Now, a term we're going to get to a little later is plead the blood. Plead, P-L-E-A-D. Plead the blood. Now, while we are not there yet, we will be there. I want you to remember, you've heard the saying, he pled the filth, haven't you? What did the person do? Well, the Constitution gives a person the right not to testify if they believe their testimony is going to impugn themselves. And so they can get behind the filth and say, I plead the filth, and the judge cannot make them say what he wants them to say if everything's in the proper order and it's all done the right way and they plead the filth. Well, the devil cannot touch me when I plead the blood. When I plead the blood in faith, and we're going to talk about what it means to plead the blood. Everybody out there ought to hear this. You ought to understand it and get it in your hearts if you want to be a victorious Christian. I see young Christians so often start out well but fail and fall by the wayside quickly because they don't learn the victory of the blood. And so I'm feeling... excuse me, in myself, the necessity of teaching this better and more and making sure you understand what it means to plead the blood. Now, the world has been captured by the devil and his powers and his evil. I mean, this world has been captured. You can look around you and you can see it. It's been captured. Well, if we're going to do anything about that captivity of Satan, we're going to learn the power of the blood. The blood is supernatural. The blood can break anything that reflects on the devil, anything that reflects his power and his ability, anything that defeats your soul and defeats your life and causes you to be in captivity to some power of wickedness or some evil force. The blood is the victory for you. The blood is the victory for you. So I cry out to you. Now, when we live by the blood, you will become obnoxious to ungodly people. I'm telling you, when you live by the blood, it gets into your psyche or your inner being. Maybe that word psyche is not too good a word. I'll pass that up. But when it gets into your spiritual life, into your soul, that's the blood, the power of the blood, the victory of the blood, the triumph of the blood, the joy of living in the blood will make you obnoxious to ungodly people. Remember when Jesus would wind up at a place where there was a demon-possessed individual, they would scream out, "Why art thou come hither to torment us before our time?" I was thinking a little while ago, the devil actually said, "Torment us." He wasn't tormenting them. They were tormented in themselves. But the blood of Jesus was as though it were torment to them, because they were coming unto judgment. They were feeling the darkness of their lifestyle. They were feeling the darkness of their demon person. And so they would scream out as though he was the tormentor. No, it was the devil who was the tormentor. And Jesus was challenging the devil. And the devil tries to make like it's him. It's the Lord tormenting the devil. No. You understand what I'm saying? I mean, I deal with that a lot as a pastor. There are people just don't like me because I represent this old-fashioned pathway. And sometimes I don't have to say nothing. They just look in my face and don't like me. You know, and that's okay. I want to so live that wickedness does not like me. I want to so live that demons are disturbed when I am in their presence. I do. And I'm not saying I'm there. That would be an awesome way to live. I'm telling you, only God can do it. Now, people captured by the world and by these spirits, and you can watch them. They become a sad sight. I mean, look at what you see on the streets. Look at what you see in the people on television and on some of these crazy shows. Excuse me. It's pitiful to look at them and see what the devil has done to them. He's made a wreck out of them. He's made a wreck out of them. And Jesus, the mighty power of Christ. And you, what you got to understand is there's only two ways to live. That's a life lived for Christ and a life lived outside of Christ. And the person living outside of Christ is going to have some difficulties. It isn't going to be an easy life. Sin is not easy. Living for the devil is not easy. The devil is a terrible taskmaster. Please let me make sure you hear that. The devil is a terrible taskmaster. He makes a wreck out of you. And he takes you further than you ever meant to go. And he does things to you and in your mind that you never thought could happen to you. Because that's what sin is. And that's what the captivity of Satan is. It's destruction. It's destruction on a slow pace. Sometimes a fast pace. Depending on how utterly people give themselves to the enemy. Now, you know I'm on a solid path today. This is just as clear as a bell. You can't believe the Bible and not believe what I'm saying to you. Now, your flesh, now you got to hear me this, church. Your flesh and your emotions and all your wisdom cannot change what's wrong in our world and the lives of those around you by flesh power and flesh wisdom and flesh ability. So much of the church is nothing but a lot of flesh. So many sermons I hear is nothing but noise, loud noise. The words they may be saying may be okay, but the spirit of their preaching lacks the anointing of the Holy Ghost. There's no power of the blood in it. There's no power of the blood in it. There's got to be power in that blood. Every morning I'm crying out, Lord, wash me today. Sprinkle me today. Sanctify me today. Let that blood do its work in me until I'm set apart for God. That's what I yearn for. That's what I'm seeking for. And that's what God is helping me with. Now, a church that does not depend upon the blood is nothing but a club. A church that the preacher and the ministry is not dependent on the power of the blood. And that needs to be said. It can't just be something, well, we take for granted that we believe in the blood. No, the devil don't play your taking for granted seriously. And he just walks right over top of your words. You've got to get serious about the blood. You've got to get serious about the blood of Jesus Christ. And you've got to take serious that there is no victory outside outside of your dependency. Your dependency has got to be personal. Your dependency has got to be personal. It just can't be a part of a church-wide attitude, a church-wide thinking. You personally have got to become dependent upon the blood of Jesus Christ. And you need to say it. I mean, I've been saved 66 years, and my life has been wonderful, and I love it. But I'm telling you, at my age, I'm still dependent on the blood. I still call on the blood of Jesus to work in my life. I still depend on that blood to keep me pure. The devil don't like pure people. The devil will do his best to defile your body and your flesh. If he can't defile you in the flesh, he'll try to get it in your eyes. And you know, the Bible says you're not even to look upon a woman to lust after her. Jesus said if you do look on a woman and lust after her, you've committed fornication in your heart. And so you need to repent. You need to repent, and the devil is going to do everything in his power to defeat you and to take you down and to destroy you. You get in a good Bible-believing church, and the devil goes bananas against you, and he is determined to get you out of there and get you somewhere where it's more relaxed. Hey, I want to go to a church that's relaxed. I want to go to a church that makes me feel good. I want to go to a church that just lifts me up and encourages me. Well, I love all of that if it's done right, but if all they do is just gloss over your wicked life and your sinful living and your conduct, well, that's just a damnation to your soul. And you need to hear this, because I'm telling you the truth, because I want you to be saved. I don't want you to be lost. Now, let's get to something, and we may need to come back later. Let's talk about pleading the blood. Do you understand what it means to plead the blood? You have to understand what it means to plead the filth, because when you plead the filth, you put the filth out in front of you, so you're protected from the judge and from his judging. Well, when you plead the blood of Jesus, you're putting the blood out in front of you. So it stands between you and any plan the devil has, any attack that the devil might desire of a given day. You plead the blood, and you depend on it, and you go about your life with the understanding, I'm depending on the blood. Don't just say I'm depending on God. Don't just say I'm depending on the Holy Spirit. Don't just say I'm depending on the Bible. Make it just as plain as you can, because the devil needs to hear the plain language. I'm depending on the blood. I'm living my life by the power of the blood. Let me tell you a dream I had one time. It was an awesome dream. I was pastoring in the little church in Black Mountain, North Carolina. That's not far from the home of Billy Graham. And as I was pastoring, you know, and doing my work with all my heart, one night I had a crazy dream. Well, no, it wasn't crazy. It was a great dream. And the devil was chasing me in the form of a serpent. I mean, this snake was chasing me for my life. And I was running for all I was worth, trying to get away from that snake. And all of a sudden, I remember specifically, I saw a lion across the road down in front of me. And it hit me, if I can get over that lion, I have defeated the devil. So I ran for that lion. And I remember, I jumped over that lion, and I saw that serpent. I looked back and saw that snake that was chasing me, and he went down in a hole on the backside of that lion, and I was free. I'll never forget it. I began to pray the next morning when I awake, and I said, "Now, Lord, that was kind of scary. Will you help me understand?" And boy, did the Holy Spirit help me understand. That lion represented the blood of Jesus Christ, the Son of God. That snake represented the devil who was out to get me. He was on my trail. When I jumped over and crossed into the field of the blood, the devil could go no further. He disappeared on the backside of that line. See, and that was the message the Holy Ghost was teaching me. And I've been teaching that ever since then. I've been teaching it ever since. Your protection is the blood. Get on the side of the blood. Get your life in the realm of the blood. And learn to say, I plead the blood. Now think about it. If you can plead the filth in front of an earthly judge, you can plead the blood in front of every work of the enemy and every work of Satan. And you simply say, I plead the blood. I plead the blood, and you mean it. Now, what are the things you do when you plead the blood? There are four things you do when you plead the blood, and I want you to make sure you get these. Number one is absolute confidence in that blood. You must have absolute confidence in that blood. To plead the blood is words in your lips with no confidence in what you plead in is a helpless endeavor. You plead the blood because you have absolute confidence that there's power in that blood. And it's not just power. It's power over everything that your enemy reflects and represents. So you've got to have absolute confidence in the blood. Then you've got to put that blood on the front line of your life. Quit living by so many emotions. Quit living by so many things that you think make you safe. Quit thinking the gun on your hip is going to keep you from the devil down the road. Quit believing anything and have any confidence in anything to take care of you but the blood. Put the blood on the front line of your life. Make the blood the very simplicity of your confidence and cling to it with all of your heart. And so very important is to put the blood. Then turn the matter over to God. Whatever the matter is that you plead in the blood about, you turn it over to God. You let the devil fight your battles. You let your devil argue with your enemies. You let the devil deal with those people who are out to destroy. You turn it over to God. Turn it over to God. And then you rest and go on about your life in a peaceful, confident way. Rest in the Lord and wait patiently for Him. The Bible says if you rest in the Lord and wait patiently for Him, you will be flying like an eagle. You can run and not be worried. You can walk and not faint. But you've got to learn to trust. And it can't just be in the Lord. It's got to be in the blood of the Lord. Understand that. To say I trust in the Lord without understanding, it's His blood that won the victory. He didn't just win the victory for you by Himself and by His flesh. And as He did miracles and as He walked about the earth, He won the victory for you by His blood. I'm confident that there are millions of people out there who are losing the battle every day because they think they trust in the blood in the Lord, but they don't trust in the blood of the Lord. It is His blood that He won the victory for you by. It is His blood. Are you hearing me? I hope you are. Now, I want to open the lines. I'm talking. I got plenty to say. But I want you to ask me the questions that really disturb you about this whole subject. I mean, let's get down to the heart of it. You're having trouble with, so many things you can have trouble with. A man or woman can become severely tempted by the enemy. And if you try to fight that temptation, you are going to lose if you do it in your own power. But if you learn to rest in the blood, to declare your victory over by the blood and tell the devil, take a trip, devil, I'm clinging to the blood. The blood is the power between you and I, and you can't cross the bloodline. You can't cross the bloodline. And tell Him and don't doubt it. I'm telling you, God will give you the victory. Now the line. I want you to call 1-800-338. Let me put phone numbers up so we can take a moment. I'd love to spend the rest of this time. I got a lot to say, but I'd love to spend it talking to you about living a victorious life by the blood of Jesus Christ. You do know that the church world is not preaching these things like it should. And your church may have never even mentioned it. And you are all bewildered by me making such an issue out of it. Well, I'm telling you, call and ask me. We won't put nobody down. We won't put your church down. We'll just tell you that it's the blood. It's the blood. It's the blood. You got to understand it is the blood, my friend. 399-7803, 1-800-338-7884, and I want you to call, and I want to help you with your question, okay? I want to help you with your question. How do you start pleading the blood? What do you do when you're pleading the blood and it seems like you're still losing? You know, all kinds of questions that you could ask. Please call me and ask me, and let me do my level best to help you. Now, you got to understand that the blood bears witness. The blood bears witness. The blood testifies. Let me take you, and I got several scriptures now, and I hope I can get to all of them if they will help you. But in the book of 1 John, remember John, he wrote the book of Revelation, he wrote St. John, he was a breathtaking disciple. Do you know in the book of St. John, he said, I am 50 times in that one book. 50 times in that one book. And seven of them were breathtaking. He said, I'm the bread of life. Then he said, I'm the light of the world. Then he said, I'm the door. Then he said, I'm the good shepherd. Then he said, I'm the resurrection. Then he said, I'm the way. And then he said, I'm the vine. Seven times. All seven of those great statements are powers that make the blood everything it is. The blood is still important for you to always remember, even though you can say the seven great I am's that Jesus said. Well, listen to this. In the book of 1 John 5, let me read two verses, 7 and 8. And there are three that bear record in heaven: the Father, the Word, and the Holy Ghost. Now, what did Trinitarians, Jesus only people do with that, I don't know. Because that's about as powerful as you can say it. And nobody could speak with greater authority than John the Revelator, John the Gospel writer, John the great apostle. He said, for there are three that bear record in heaven. Three that bear record in heaven: the Father, the Word, and the Holy Ghost. And these three are one. These three are one. There is a unity in the Trinity that is inexpressible, beyond human understanding, and is absolutely beautiful. Then he goes on to say, and there are three that bear witness in earth. There are three that bear witness in earth. Notice this now: the Spirit and the water, that's the Word, and the blood. Spirit, water, and blood. Spirit, Word of God, blood of Jesus Christ. The blood of Jesus Christ, the Word of God, the Holy Spirit. Have you got that? There are three that bear witness in the earth, and these three are in one. And these three are in one. Now, that's a victory that is so breathtaking and so wonderful. Wow. Wow. See, you got the Word of God to depend on. You got the Holy Ghost sustaining you. And you got the blood of Jesus Christ breaking every power of the devil. Every power of the devil are broken by the blood of Jesus Christ. Now, that's beautiful. If you have a question, you feel free to call. The NIV really messes that up in case you have an NIV Bible. But I'm telling you, there are three that bear witness in heaven. There are three that bear witness on earth. And the earth is the water and the blood and the Spirit. The water and the blood and the Spirit. But don't you miss that blood. Now, if you got a Trinity and you've got three and one's missing, then you completely destroy the power of the other two. You've got to understand the Bible is a unified book. It is an absolute, perfect, unified book. And it's really overwhelming. Really overwhelming. Now, the Bible is called the Everlasting Gospel. The blood of Jesus makes the Bible the everlasting gospel, because this blood that Jesus spilt was divine blood. Don't you let anybody tell you the blood of Jesus was just human blood, just a Jewish man. No, it was a Jewish man, but it was divine blood. Divine blood. And you may have a question about that, because some people do doubt that the blood of Jesus was divine. Well, it couldn't have atoned for your sins if it would have been human blood. It had to be divine blood. It had to be divine blood. And you must understand that. And that's a good place there for a question if you have one you want to ask. I want to read that everlasting gospel. Oh, I love it. I love to know I've got a gospel that's everlasting. That's in the chapter 13. Let me see here. Make sure I get it right. 13:20. I'm reading now. Now the God of peace, God of peace that brought again from the dead our Lord Jesus Christ. Oh, I like that. Now, the God of peace that brought again our Lord Jesus Christ from the dead, that great shepherd of the sheep through the blood of the everlasting covenant. Through the blood of the everlasting covenant. See, the Bible is a covenant for eternity. The Bible will never go the Bible will never be less than perfect. It will never fail. It will be forever. It is an eternal book. And the blood is the covenant of the book. It is the, you see, when you claim the Bible and you don't claim the blood, there's no power in the Bible without the blood. There's no power in the Bible without the blood. The power of the Bible is in the blood. The victory of the Bible is in the blood. Standing on the promises with the blood behind them gives you absolute assurance. Nothing can stop you. Nothing can keep you from the victory. Nothing can keep you from making it to the everlasting shores. Hallelujah. What a day. What a day. What a day. Now, I'm dealing with things that are so breathtaking. I mean, these are really wonderful. And I would suspect there are people out there that are just out of this. You just don't understand. You've never heard it. All right, get on your phone and let me try to help you. Now, I want to spend these last times. Hear me give you the number again, 704-391-0588. 704-391-0588. And the toll-free number, 1-800-338-7884. Now, I've got a booklet I want to offer you today on this subject. I do this all the time. And these booklets have already, I mean, they're all over the world. I get amazed when I hear where booklets have shown up and where videos have shown up and things we've done have shown up. And I'm thrilled about it. I am dedicated to that. And I want you to have this booklet on this subject that answers all of these questions for you so that you can dig in. I want you to dig in. Don't just stay on the shatter. On the sideline. That's where so many people say is on the sideline. Now, I'm going to do something I don't normally do. I've got two books here by a Presbyterian pastor. Can you hear me? Presbyterian. Andrew Murray. He's been dead probably 100 years. I'm not sure how long, but he was a South African pastor. Andrew Murray, his church young people were praying for a Holy Ghost revival. And one day they ran over to the manse. Presbyterians call it a manse. They ran over to the manse to tell Brother Andrew that revival had started and they wanted him to come over. Well, the pastor nervously went over to the sanctuary where the young people were praying, and they were just, I mean, it was electric. The place was in an uproar. God had come down and visited that crowd, and the pastor thought, sure as the world, my kids have lost their senses. They've gone off into fanaticism. They've lost it. And so Andrew went back to the manse, all disturbed, and got on his face, and the Holy Ghost spoke to him and said, son, your problem is you don't recognize my presence. You don't recognize my glory. I don't know exactly the words God told him, but God got a hold of him, sent him back, and it became one of the great revivals of the past history of the church because a bunch of young people were praying and crying out to God. And our church is doing the same thing right now. Well, I want you to call and get this book. The price of it is $12.50. I think that's right, $12.50, The Power of the Blood by this Andrew Murray, this Presbyterian pastor. He will tell you in great terms and beautiful terminologies everything I have said to you today. I mean, this is powerful. Let me read some of the chapter titles, and this will intrigue you, I think. Listen, what the Scripture teaches about the blood. Redemption in the or by blood, a reconciliation through the blood, cleansing by the blood, sanctification through the blood, cleansed by the blood to serve the living God, dwelling in the highest. I read that a while ago from Hebrews 10. Dwelling in the highest, life in the blood, victory through the blood, heavenly joy through the blood. I mean, these things are overwhelming. You can be a happy Christian if you live by the power of the blood. You can be a joyous Christian if you live by the power of the blood. You can be a clean, pure Christian if you've been sanctified by the blood. All of this by the blood is powerful, and I'd like for you to have this book. Call, and they'll take your order, and we'll mail it to you. If it's out of print, I mean, if our stock is out, I know we got one. If our stock is out, we'll order it right quick and let you know, and we'll get it to you. And if that one is too expensive, here's another one by the same man, Andrew Murray, The Blood of the Cross. the blood of the cross. It's only $7.95, okay? Seven, let me see here, seven something. Well, you know, $8. Call and get one of them, will you? I would love for you to get involved in this subject, and let's build some saints out there that are stalwart, that are powerful, that are anointed, that are full of the unction of God, and that live in. It used to be you would announce one of those books and you'd get a dozen orders at least. Now you announce them and you're blessed if you get a couple, because people aren't aware and they really aren't concerned. Most Christians are just lazy, do-nothing people who sit on a church pew and they are not digging, they're not growing, they're not maturing, they're in and out. And I don't want that to be true with you. I want you to grow up in the Lord. And I want you to become anointed in the Holy Ghost. And I want your life to be a blessing. I want you to be a prayer warrior in your community, that those around you will come looking for you when there's a burden, when there's a need, when there's a challenge. And you can be a church. You know, nothing is as wonderful in a church as if you've got a few prayer warriors, some real on fire saints of God, men and women, who know how to pray and who pray and seek God, and the church becomes alive in prayer and by the power of the blood when we really begin to go after the Lord with all of our hearts, with all of our hearts. Did you know that Jesus Christ, when he died on the cross, there was actually a triumphant experience in Jerusalem? I mean, this is a breathtaking one. When Jesus died on the cross, when the veil of the temple was rent in twain. How many of you understand why the veil in the Jewish temple was rent when Jesus was crucified and resurrected? That's because the veil in the temple separated the people from God. Separated the people from God. They couldn't go in. Only the high priest could go in behind the veil. Well, when Jesus died, the veil was rent, because the blood of Jesus had just opened the door for every one of you out there listening to me, from everybody in Jerusalem, from the whole church. Well, no wonder the early church turned the world upside down. They lived in the power of this blood. They preached it. They walked in it. They depended on it. It was their confidence. They had great assurance. Now, let me read you something that happened when Jesus rent the veil in the temple. That means the blood was spilt. The blood offering was accepted. God had accepted the blood offering. Now, Jesus, when he had cried again with a loud voice, yielded up the ghost. Jesus died. Jesus died. And behold, the veil of the temple was rent in twain. The veil of the temple down in Jerusalem was rent in twain from the top to the bottom, from the top to the bottom, and the earth did quake and the rocks rent. Woo! The earth did quake and the rocks rent. The Savior had been crucified. The blood had drained out of his body, every drop of it. And every drop bought you and I a million years. Every drop brought you and I a million years. If we are trusting the blood and depending on. And the graves, these are graves in Jerusalem, were opened. And many saints of the Lord, many of the saints of God, which slept, arose. And came out of the grave after the resurrection. And went into the city and appeared unto many. Now this happened, and this is in Matthew 27, beginning with verse 50. Go read it for yourself. When Jesus was crucified, he had shed his blood. The blood of Jesus had atoned for the sins of the world. The blood of Jesus had so shook everything until the veil in the temple down in Jerusalem was split in twain. And here were saints of God around Jerusalem who had been buried. And that sacrifice was so breathtaking that the earth began to shake. I mean, a great earthquake. And everything began to turn topsy-turvy. And the graves of these saints were opened. And they came up out of their graves and went into Jerusalem and appeared unto many. Now, that gives you some idea of the effect of that blood. They could not have come out of that earth had it not been for the blood. It was the blood offering, the blood covering, the blood cleansing, the victory, the triumph, the glory of the blood that caused these saints to arise out of their graves and to be seen in Jerusalem. Now that gives you some idea of how breathtaking that blood is and how mighty it is to save. And that's fixing to happen again. My Bible says in Isaiah 26, that was said about 3,000 years ago, that the earth is going to cast out the dead. Cast out the dead. I mean, the earth is going to cast us saints if you're in the grave, if you have been buried by the time of the rapture, going to cast you out into the air, and the grave will be burst open and you'll be resurrected. Oh, I tell you what, friend, you begin to talk about these kind of things and it's overwhelming and it's going to happen. You don't listen to me and say, oh, that man's into fantasy. You go ahead and think that. But I'm here to tell you, I'm not into fantasy. I'm into triumphant truth and the wonder of this Bible and the power of the blood. See, it's all the power of the blood. You got to understand that, the power of the blood. Now, something that I discovered recently, I'm not sure I will find it quickly, and that's in the book of Revelation. You remember in the book of Revelation, over after the seven-year tribulation period, after now, the seven-year tribulation period is over. And after that, the Bible says that Jesus mounts a white horse up in heaven. And the saints of God that have been raptured, that gone up in the rapture, they're up there with him. And now he's coming back to the earth to set up his kingdom on the earth. Jesus coming back to the earth to set up his kingdom on the earth. And when you look and see him, he has got a cape on, a coat on. I guess we'd call this a outer garment. He's got an outer garment on that has been dipped in blood. Dipped in blood. And he comes back from heaven with that outer garment on his body, on his shoulders, and it's dripping with blood. It's dipped in blood. And you say, where in the world, how would blood be of such an important factor? Well, you see, when Jesus was crucified, and then he was resurrected, he said to the woman who met him at the tomb, touch me not. I have not yet ascended to my God and to your God. And he ascended and put his blood that he has spilt on that cross, put it on the altar in heaven. The blood of Jesus is on the heavenly altar in the heavenly temple right now. Right now, this blood that I'm preaching about is on the altar in heaven, in the temple in heaven. It's up there. You can depend on it. And Jesus, before he comes back to this earth, at the battle of Armageddon, after the seven-year tribulation period, finishing up all the judgment of the wicked, getting the world ready for the kingdom of God that will last 1,000 years on this earth, he goes to the altar in the temple and dips his cape in that blood. Dips his cape in his own blood. It would do him no good to wear the blood of another. It would do no good for him to dip his coat in the blood of another. He doesn't come down here to get blood on his garment from fighting the enemy. I'm telling you, all he's got to do is speak the word, and it's like a sword coming out of his mouth, and it defeats the enemy. And so Jesus will come back to the earth with his cape dipped in blood, the blood off the altar of God in heaven. Now, if that doesn't convince you of the power of this blood, I would not know where to start. I mean, that is just so breathtaking. When I realized it one Sunday morning preaching, it hit me, and I'll never forget what happened to me that morning. I went ecstatic. It was overwhelming to me that Jesus dipped his cape in his own blood on the altar in heaven and comes back to set up the kingdom of Jesus Christ on this earth, defeat all the enemies, the Antichrist, and the false prophet will be cast into the lake of fire. The devil will be cast into a bottomless pit and later into the lake of fire. And the wicked will be judged. And this earth will become a place of righteousness and holiness and purity. And for all of this to happen, the Son of God dips his cape in his own blood, the blood of the cross. the blood of a divine Savior who bled and died for us. Now, I know that some of you have never heard that before. In fact, I'd never heard it before till the Holy Spirit brought it to my attention, evident in the Scripture. There's no doubt about it once you study the Bible. And it is so beautiful. And you may have a question. I'd love to answer your question. So grab your phone. Why would the phones not be ringing off? This is the grandest subject a man could ever talk about. You talk about victory. You talk about triumph. You talk about the devil. See, death has no power against the blood of Jesus Christ. Death, the devil, none of the powers of the devil have any power against the blood of Jesus Christ, the Son of God. When you trust in that blood, you have the victory, my friend. When you trust in that blood, you can triumph every time. You can triumph every time. Now, I want to forget things. I want so much for you to take this home with you. I really do. I want you to live by it. The saints of God, they go to the veil and pray by the power of the blood. By the power of the blood. We overcome by the power of the blood. We're new creatures by the power of the blood. Everything in this blood is victory, my friends. Everything in this blood is victories. And I want you to learn to live in this. I wanted to get a hold of you. Now, in case you came you wasn't on earlier, and you come later, I should have said, let me read the opening scriptures again and make sure we get what God is saying to us. I'm telling you, grab the phone while I'm reading this. Let's have two or three questions. Somebody call and tell me how much you depend on the blood. Do you remember when you were saved and suddenly an old rough sinner, you lied and cheated and drunk whiskey and fornicated and every kind of sin you could imagine. And suddenly you came to Christ and you trusted Him. And you turned your life over to Him. And He washed you. And you felt like you had been washed with 1,000 mops. I mean, you were clean from your head to your toe. You were a new man because the blood of Jesus had washed you. I'm here to tell you, there is no sin that you forsake and repent of, genuinely forsake and genuinely repent of, that Jesus will not wash it completely away. He will cast it into the sea of forgetfulness. He will never remember it against you again. You will be a clean man. You will be a clean woman. You will have a clean life. It will be a transforming experience. And you don't have to go to hell. I don't care who you are and how wicked you've been, unless you have blasphemed the Holy Ghost, and you would have no interest in what I'm talking about if you had. You can be born again. You can be washed in the blood, and you can get ready to go to heaven. And you can do it right now while I am on this radio with you. In just a moment, I'm going to turn my head up to God. And I'm going to pray for those who are listening to me throughout the radio audience. Wherever, it doesn't matter to me, in Africa, in Australia, in New Zealand, in South Africa, in Russia, in England, South America. It doesn't matter to me where you're hearing, because with the internet and Facebook, you can hear me anywhere on the face of the globe. You can take your little telephone just like this, and in a moment's time, I can be right there watching me at the same way I'm watching you there. And I'll be seeing you coming to me from somewhere where I don't know, but coming through all the systems and back to me. What a God we serve to make this available in this last day. I know there's a lot of sin out there, but the gospel is also going. And I love that gospel going forward. I want to read the scripture. I want to read it for you. Listen, having therefore, brethren, boldness to enter into the holiest by the blood of Jesus. Notice that, by the blood of Jesus. By a new and living way, which He hath consecrated for us through the veil, that is to say, His flesh. He had to shed His blood in His body. Divine blood. Remember, the Holy Ghost had come upon Mary. She did not know a man. She said, how can I be pregnant? I don't know a man. And the angel said, the spirit, the power of the highest shall overshadow thee. Therefore, that holy thing which shall be born of you shall be called the Son of God. Isn't that beautiful? And having an high priest over the house of God, let us draw near with a true heart. You got to have a true heart. And in full assurance of faith. Full assurance, that means you really believe God. You're willing to trust him. You're willing to take God at his word. If you can't take God at his word, you're sure crazy for listening to anything the media is saying, and even maybe many of your neighbors are saying. But you can take God at his word. You can depend upon God, my friend. God is faithful every time in every way. There's no case in which he's not faithful. And having a high priest over the house of God, let us draw near with a full assurance of faith, having our hearts sprinkled, having our evil hearts sprinkled from an evil conscience. See, the blood will wash away. It'll even clean up your conscience. Those things up here that's disturbing the daylight set up. You can't sleep because you did somebody wrong. You can't sleep because you're unfaithful to your sweetheart wife. You can't sleep because you let yourself go to bed with some old fornicating man. You can't sleep because you've lied and cursed and told nasty jokes. Well, he will cleanse your conscience by the blood. He will wash your conscience by the blood. He will make you clean as the riven snow. You will be as though you have never sinned in your life. You will be as though you have never sinned when Jesus washes you in the blood of his sacrifice. When Jesus washes you in the blood of his sacrifice, and our bodies washed in pure water. Let us hold fast the profession of our faith without wavering, for he is faithful that promised. Are you willing to trust in the blood? Are you willing to depend upon the blood? The blood is your life, my dear friend. The blood is your life, my friend. Now, let me tell you. Let me read it to you. It says, for the life of the flesh is in the blood. For the life of the flesh is in the blood. And I've given it to you. I've given it to you upon the altar to make the sacrifice. Listen now. To make atonement for your sins. For your soul. For your sins. To wash you. To make you pure. For it is the blood that maketh an atonement for the soul. It is the blood that maketh an atonement for the soul. You go to church and you sing the songs and you profess religion and you don't trust in the blood. You're as lost as if you've never been to church. You may be a preacher and you may stand in the pulpit and preach every Sunday and you may believe if I just take the Bible at face value and believe the Bible, I don't need anything else. And you've never been to an altar and asked Jesus to wash you from your sins in the blood. You're just as lost as if you didn't go to church. You're just as lost as if you were a murderer. You're just as lost if you were Hitler or anyone else who died in their wickedness. I'm telling you, it's only the blood. It's only the blood. It's only the blood. Do you grab me? Do you understand what I'm saying? Am I getting through to everybody out there? It's the blood. It's the blood. The blood washes. The blood sanctifies. The blood makes you pure. The blood makes you clean. What a God we serve. What a Savior. What wonderful sacrifice. I am grateful for all his mercy. And I want to pray. Every one of you listening to me, regardless of what the sin is that you're dealing with, regardless of how deeply you've involved yourself in wicked living, regardless of how long you've been listening to God calling you and you've not taken time to hear him, I want to say to you today that Jesus is ready to change your life. Jesus is ready to make somebody different out of you. Jesus is ready to change you and make a new creature out of you. And you will be grateful forever that you turned to him and trusted him. And I'm begging of you, turn to Christ. Turn to Christ right now, will you? Let him come in and take over your life and fully surrender to him. Fully commit your way to him. Fully dedicate yourself to him. Father, I come to you with friends all over radio land, all over internet, to Facebook. It matters not where they are, who they are, what color their skin is. None of that even matters. All that matters is here's a soul that's coming to you, Father. And I'm claiming the blood of Jesus with them. I repent. Follow me out there now. I repent of my sins because of Christ's sacrifice. I turn from my wicked ways. I turn from my sinful ways. And I'm clinging to the blood of Jesus to wash me from every sin. Right now, I'm fully trusting him to wash away my guilt, to wash away my sins, to change my life, to make a new creature out of me, that I may serve you and live for you forever. I mean it, Father. I'm surrendering my life to you. I'm giving all to you. I pray out there that God is doing it in somebody's life. I really am. I really am. And you on the air, may I help you, please?
Yes. Brother Chambers, this is Uncle Davis calling from Cleveland.
Okay.
I was calling to say I just talked to my sister, and I got prayer requested for one sister. The other one has had a family problem, so please lift her up in prayer, too. Her name is Martha Sanford, and her family, God knows.
Okay. And so you want prayer for them. Do you believe in the power of the blood, my dear sister?
Oh, yes, I do.
Are you hearing the program that I'm on right now?
I'm not hearing it. You know, I read your messages. That's in the, you know.
Well, I wish you were listening. I mean, so you can get it on the internet right there in Cleveland or on Facebook. Do you have Facebook?
I don't have Facebook.
Oh, but you have an internet. All right, you can go on your internet and find paulcreek.org. You can get it live every Saturday. Now, let me pray. Father, in the name of Jesus, I bring my dear sister from Cleveland, Tennessee. I bring her to you, Father, for a miracle in these requests. I will not try to repeat the names. You heard them. I claim a miracle for each name that she named to us. We want to see your hand, Father, break all over America. We want to see multitudes come to know Christ and love Him. We want to see miracles of divine healing. You are a God of supernatural power. You're a God of majestic power. And I claim a miracle in every need today. In Jesus' name, amen.
Thank you so much. Brother Chambers, there was another person I was going to mention, but that's okay. God knows who I was going to mention.
All right. Well, we will pray with you now. Why don't you make sure you get me those names? Can you text me those names so I can put it in my Bible and pray for them this coming week?
Yes, I can text you the names.
All right. 704-578-5788. 704-578-5788. You understand I'm on the radio, and you should know we're on the radio every week from 1 to 2, okay? You should be listening if you call me, or call me at a different time, but I care about you, and so I'm delighted to pray with you. Text that to me now, and God bless your heart. Now, friend, there's so many needs out there. We have a world that is in topsy-turvy condition. And you can look anywhere you want to look, and there are needs almost everywhere you look. Well, the power of the blood is mighty in prayer. Now, if you're a prayer warrior and you're praying for other people, I want to help you understand that your prayers in the power of the blood will break through like a storm. And if you're praying without knowing that your victory of entrance in prayer is the blood, then you're missing so much. I know God's interested in you, and He can hear you however He wants to hear you. But He requires you to make your petition in the blood of Jesus Christ. And the name you always use in prayer is in the name of Jesus. Remember, Jesus said, "Ask the Father anything in my name, and He will do it." Now, He said in my name because it related to the blood, His sacrifice, His death on the cross. And so I want you to learn that and live in the power of the blood. We have no interest in helping anybody but every one of you. Nobody special but everybody individually. We care about all. We're here for all of you. We're here to get people back to the Bible, back to the truth of the Scripture, back to a Holy Ghost-filled life and walking with Him. Now, I've enjoyed it today. There'll be another program next week on miracles. Last week, the miracle of the Bible. Today, the miracle of the blood. I plan to preach tomorrow one of my sermons on the miracle of the great I am. The miracle of the great I am. I'm excited about that. The miracle of the great I am. Now, I need to hear from you. I'm dependent on you to help pay radio bills, okay? If you're listening by radio, internet, Facebook, in any way, I promise you, every penny comes to this ministry goes to the kingdom of God. It's not meant for any reason and any purpose, but to magnify the holy God. Our God that we serve is faithful. Do you understand that? He is faithful, and He cares about you. He really cares about you. So God bless you. May the joy of the Lord be your strength. Don't miss next week. Let me hear from you. Be a partner with us. God bless you in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, in the name of the Lord.
How a Savior came from glory, how he gave his life on Calvary to save a wretch like me. I heard about his groaning, of his precious blood's atoning. Then I repented of my sins and won the victory. Oh, victory in Jesus, my Savior forever. He sought me and he bought me with his redeeming blood. Cleansing power revealing how he made the lame to walk again, and he caused the blind to see. And then I cried, dear Jesus, come and heal my broken spirit. Then somehow Jesus came and brought to me the victory. My Savior forever. And he sought me and he bought me with his redeeming blood. He loved me ere I knew him, and all my love is due him. And he plunged me